Good morning. Please keep the family of Shirley Green in your prayers. This past week, she contracted COVID and died last evening. So the family is feeling really sad. For all of us to be safe, masks and social distancing are required while in the building. We are learning to engage with our online community. If you have a Facebook account, please take out your phone right now and check in at Trinity. Please add a comment to the worship video when you hear something meaningful in the worship service. We're using a screen. Unfortunately, the camera doesn't stretch that far for our online friends. Please use the bulletin, which can be found at Trinity's website, tlcgreencastle.org. Click News and Events, and then Bulletins. To be safe, please pray the words and hum the music. Sandra and Matt will sing. The New Renewal team continues to invite us to share our God moments to help us notice God active in our lives. Please fill out the form in your bulletin and place it in the offering plate at the back as you leave. Our online friends can leave a message in the comments section. Where did you see God this week? Our service includes Holy Communion today. If you're joining us online, please gather a piece of bread and cup of juice or wine. Those in the sanctuary have received a prepackaged communion kit. You'll be instructed on when to open the kit. Please stay after the service for the annual congregational meeting, either in the sanctuary or online via Zoom. The information was emailed. Let's close our eyes, take a deep breath, and notice God noticing us as we begin our worship. Please pray the words and hum as Matt and Sandra sing, "Prepare the Way." The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. We praise you, O God, for this Advent wreath. Advent means coming. As we light the second candle on this wreath, kindle within us the fire of your Spirit, that we may be light shining in the darkness as we prepare for Christ's coming. Enlighten us with your grace, your unconditional love and forgiveness, that we may welcome others as you have welcomed us. Grant this through Christ our Lord, whose coming is certain and whose day draws near. Amen. Please pray the words and hum the music as Sandra and Matt sing the second verse of O Come, Emmanuel. We pray together. God of the prophets, into the wilderness you sent your messenger to prepare for the coming of your Son. In every age, your word has called your people from death to life and from darkness into light. In our own day, you have raised up voices who call us to turn and mend our ways. Open our hearts to your good news. Help us to repent and make us ready to welcome the Christ who has come, is here now, and will come again at the end of the age. Amen. Please stand for the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the first chapter. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight.'" John the baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and redeemer. Amen. And so now it begins. The Gospel of Mark, that is. This second Sunday of Advent, we begin at the beginning. Remember last Sunday, the first Sunday of Advent, we started the new year in the middle of Mark's Gospel to remind us that Advent, waiting in hope for the coming of Jesus, isn't so much about Christmas, although a piece of that is in the mix. Instead, the season of Advent focuses on the mystery of the coming of Jesus in our lives today and also in the age to come. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Do you notice that Mark's sentence structure is a bit off? No verb. The grammar police among us would not give him stellar marks. Many scholars think this is actually the title of Mark's book. Mark sets us up right from the beginning. Mark wants us to look at his book as good news. That's where the word gospel comes from. Gospel in Greek means good news. Everything we read from Mark over this next year will frame what happens in Jesus' life as good news for us and the world. Mark lets us know from the get-go who Jesus is. Jesus, the Son of God. It'll be fun having inside information as we listen to Mark describing how the people around Jesus struggle with who he is, and we already know. Beginnings matter and set the tone for what to expect. Mark's title gives us a glimpse as to what he hopes to accomplish. The beginning of the good news. That's Mark's title. Mark's entire gospel is only meant to be a beginning. The significance of Jesus and what happens in the next 16 chapters extends all the way into our... Ooh. Sorry, Josie. All the way into our lives, into this second Sunday of Advent 2020. Mark wants us to know that God's work isn't finished. That's incredible good news. As we battle COVID fatigue and continued political divisiveness in our country, God's work isn't finished. Mark begins his good news not with the birth of a baby, but all the way back to the prophet Isaiah. In Isaiah's time, the Jews are in exile, taken as political prisoners in Babylon. Times are uncertain and chaotic. The people are anxious and feel abandoned. Sound familiar? It's important to remember that prophets in the Bible are not fortune tellers. They don't tell the future. What prophets do is declare the word of the Lord. And sometimes that's a word of comfort, and sometimes it's a word of challenge. God declares a word of comfort through Isaiah to the Jews in exile. You aren't alone. Oh my, do we need that word today? You aren't alone. I'm coming. Nothing is going to keep me away. Whatever it takes, I'm coming. Mountains won't keep me away. Make my path straight. Ultimately, a generation after they are forcibly removed from Israel, the Jews return from exile. And now, fast forward to John. God's promise continues. John certainly looks the part of a prophet, dressed in funny clothes and eating bugs for breakfast. God declares through John, "Get ready, I'm coming." John shows up in the wilderness to spread the message. He offers a baptism of repentance as a way to prepare. Even though it seems rather strange to us, John's dress and wilderness lifestyle are no surprise to the Jews of that time. That's what Old Testament prophets look like. That's what Old Testament prophets act like. The people expect to be invited into the Jordan to be baptized. The baptism of repentance is not a new idea. For generations, the ancient Jews used baptism of repentance as a sign of changed hearts and minds. And remember, repentance is that big church word that means to change direction, change your mind. John invites the people who follow him into the desert to confess their sins and enter the water to be baptized as a sign of their changed heart. This baptism of repentance is a symbol the people use to show they want to live their lives differently. God declares through John, "Get ready, I'm coming." And whenever God breaks in, amazing things happen. For the folks listening in the wilderness, John's message is startling. I baptize with water. The one more powerful than I will baptize with the Holy Spirit. God keeps promises, and God is about to do a new thing. Mark describes in his next 16 chapters the new thing God is doing. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. For Mark, the good news of Jesus Christ proceeds from the prophet proclaiming the news to prepare. God is coming. And then the story continues with us. As we celebrate the Advent season, lighting the second candle, we wait, expecting Christ to come to us. Each Sunday, we write on slips of paper in the bulletin or comments in the Facebook where we've seen God this week. Christ is active in our lives right now. Christ, present in our hearts through the Holy Spirit, is found everywhere love and connection abound. And as we've been discovering, also, especially in the least, the lost, and the lonely. And the mystery is that we also wait in hope for Christ to come at the end of the age. We live in that in-between time of already, not yet. Christ is coming to us. And what can we do to get ready? John's ideas include confess your sins, get baptized, repent. Other spiritual practices come to mind, like daily prayer, Bible reading, generous giving, worship, spiritual friendships. God will come whether we do these things or not. But knowing God is on the way, why wouldn't we want to do them? God loves you. So I invite you now to close your eyes and rest in that love. God invites you to breathe deeply and let go. Sense God's love in and around you. My friends, Christ has come. Christ is come, and Christ will come again. May we here at Trinity and our online friends take seriously God's invitation to prepare. Please pray the words and hum the music as Sandra and Matt sing, "The King Shall Come." Please stand as you are able. On this second Sunday of Advent, let us pray for this weary world. When you hear the words, "Hear us, O God," please respond with, "Your mercy is great." Come to the church, O faithful God. Assist our Bishop Jim, our Pastor Barb, and all who minister in the church. Show us what is your way and where are your paths, and awaken all the baptized to the guidance of your Holy Spirit. Hear us, O God. Mercy is great. Come to the earth, O creating God. As the seasons change, protect all that lives. Mend the wounds of environmental damage and restore balance to ecosystems. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Come to the nations, O sovereign God. Inspire governmental officials to strive for peace within their land and between countries. Remember the people of Afghanistan and Ethiopia. Guide the nations toward cooperative efforts when facing global issues. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Come to our country, O righteous God. Teach us how to end discrimination and to value diversity. Bring political parties into helpful conversation with each other. Assist the unemployed and uphold people with physical and intellectual disabilities. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Come to all who are facing the coronavirus, O compassionate God. Protect the vulnerable, heal the sick, embrace the dying, sustain medical workers, prepare a vaccine, end this scourge. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Come to all who suffer, O merciful God. Empower us to feed the hungry in our nation and around the world. Gather into your healing embrace those who are afraid, lonely, sick, or struggling with depression. We pray especially for Shirley, Paul, Dot, Carolyn, Mimi, Ray, Karen, and others we name in our hearts and minds at this time. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Come to us, O eternal God, as you came to the saints. We remember a saint, especially Saint Nicholas, in his care for children, and those we name in our hearts and minds before you now, especially Shirley. Bring us with them into the fulfillment of your promises. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Come to us, O God, and receive our prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Everything we have, do, and are is a gift from God. God invites us to use our gifts of time, talent, and money and other blessings to love others. We join God in the work of healing our broken world. We pray, offering ourselves and our contributions to the glory of God. As we wait together for the day of Christ's coming, may these, our offerings of time, talent, money, and ourselves, be signs of God's love in our broken, hurting world. In our giving, may we grow in the compassion and justice of Jesus, in whose name we pray, and whose coming we anticipate with joy. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Even as gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we pray the prayer our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Even as we watch and wait, Christ is here. Christ is present in your lives and in this meal of Holy Communion. Eat, drink, and be nourished. Please be seated and take your prepackaged communion and pull off the very top layer. If you get the whole thing, just put the cup aside. The host is in that top layer. The body of Christ given for you. And now, hold it at the top so it doesn't spray all over the place. Take the next layer off, and you should see the juice, the blood of Christ shed for you. Please stand. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. How grateful we are for this family meal you have prepared for us, most gracious God. As we have gathered around your table, Might we be open to receiving the gift of your love in the food we have shared. Let it nourish us when we feel depleted, sustain us when times are difficult, comfort us when we are sorrowful, and enhance our joys when our cups overflow. Let it be that the meal we have shared will enable us to nurture others through the gift of this bread of life. For the meal we have eaten, O God, make us truly thankful. Amen. Please remain in your seats for the congregational meeting. Christ's peace be with you. And I invite you to turn and wave and share the peace. Those folks who are online, please share the peace by the Facebook comments. May the Lord make you increase in love for one another, nurturing one another in our community of faith, uplifting one another in times of struggle or sorrow, sharing with one another in all that you possess. May the Lord make you abound in love for all, giving of yourselves the way Christ gives to you, witnessing to the ever-widening circles of God's love, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit who breathes life into all of God's children. May the Lord make love grow within you and extend to all around you as we together we await his coming. And may God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you and remain with you always. Amen. Pray the words and hum the music as Sandra and Matt sing. Go out into the world in peace after the congregational meeting, sharing the light and love of Christ through your words and actions. Thanks be to God. We will. If you all will be patient, we have a little bit of setting up to do for the Zoom, and then we'll begin. Thank you, Miss Sandra. As usual, that was lovely. Has the Lord sent you joy yet? Has the Lord sent you joy yet?
Yeah, this is a really amazing thing. My husband came home Friday night with a cheesecake decorated like a keyboard. Happy birthday, Sandra. He's never done it.
Oh.